Penguin Random House Audio presents My Husband's Wife by Jane Corry, read for you by Rosalyn Landor. Prologue. Flash of metal, thunder in my ears. This is the 5 o'clock news. The radio, chirping merrily from the pine dresser, laden with photographs, holidays, graduation, wedding, a pretty blue and pink plate, a quarter bottle of Jack Daniels, partially hidden by a birthday card. My head is killing me, my right wrist as well. The pain in my chest is scary. So too is the blood. I slump to the floor, soothed by the cold of the black slate, and I shake. Above me on the wall is a white house in Italy, studded with purple bougainvillea, a honeymoon memento. Can a marriage end in murder, even if it's already dead? That painting will be the last thing I see, but in my mind, I am reliving my life. So it's true what they say about dying. The past comes back to go with you. The Daily Telegraph. Tuesday, 20th of October, 2015. The artist Ed MacDonald has been found stabbed to death in his home. It is thought that... Part 1. 15 years earlier. Chapter 1. Lily. Late September 2000. Nervous? Ed asks with a note of sympathy in his voice. He's pouring out his favourite breakfast cereal, Rice Krispies. Usually, I like them too. As a child, I was obsessed by the elfin-faced figures on the packet, and the magic hasn't quite left. But today, I don't have the stomach to eat anything. Nervous? I repeat, fastening my pearl earrings in the little mirror next to the sink. Our flat is small. Compromises were made. About what? I almost add. Nervous about the first day of married life, perhaps? Nervous because we should have taken more time to find a better flat instead of one in the wrong part of Clapham, where both bedroom and bathroom are so small that my one tube of Rimmel foundation and my two lipsticks, rose pink and ruby red, snuggle up next to the teaspoons in the cutlery drawer. Or nervous about going back to work after our honeymoon in Italy. A week in Sicily, knocking back bottles of masala, grilled sardines and slabs of pecorino cheese in a hotel paid for by Ed's grandmother. Maybe I'm nervous about all these things. Normally, I love my work. Until now, I've been in employment law, helping people, especially women, who've been unfairly sacked. Looking after the underdog, that's me. I nearly became a social worker like Dad. But thanks to a determined careers teacher at school, here I am, a 25-year-old, newly qualified solicitor on minimum wage, struggling to do up the button at the back of my navy blue skirt. No one wears bright colours in a law office, apart from the secretaries, or so I was told when I started. And the fact that I was advised to wear a skirt suit, not trousers, don't even get me started. "We're moving you to criminal," my boss announced by way of a wedding gift. "We think you'll be good at it." So now, on my first day back, I'm preparing to go to prison. To see a man who's been accused of murder. I've never been inside a prison before. Never wanted to. It's an unknown world. One reserved for people who have done wrong. I'm the kind of person who goes straight back if someone has given me too much change in the newsstand when I buy my monthly copy of Cosmo. Ed is doodling now. His head is bent slightly to the left as he sketches on a notepad next to his cereal. My husband is always drawing. It was one of the first things that attracted me to him. "Advertising," he said with a rueful shrug when I asked what he did. "On the creative side. But I'm going to be a full-time artist one day. This is just temporary, to pay the bills." I liked that. A man who knew where he was going. but when he's drawing or painting, Ed doesn't even know which planet he's on. Right now, he's forgotten he even asked me a question. But suddenly it's important for me to answer it. Nervous? No, I'm not nervous. There's a nod. But despite that earlier, kind tone, I'm not sure he's really heard me. When Ed's in the zone, the rest of the world doesn't matter. Not even my fib. Why? I ask myself, as I take his left hand, the one with the shiny gold wedding ring. Don't I tell him how I really feel? Why not confess that I feel sick and that I need to go to the loo, even though I've only just been? A shiver passes down my spine as I spray duty-free Chanel No. 5, a present from Ed, using another wedding gift check, on the inside of both wrists. Last month, a solicitor from a rival firm was stabbed in both lungs when he went to see a client in Wandsworth. Come on, I say, anxiety sharpening my usually light voice. We're both going to be late. Reluctantly, he rises from the rickety chair that the former owner of our flat had left behind. He's a tall man, my new husband. Lanky, with an almost apologetic way of walking, as if he would really rather be somewhere else. As a child, apparently, his hair was as golden as mine is today. We knew you were a lily the first time we saw you, my mother has always said. But now it's a sandy brown. And he has thick fingers that betray no hint of the artist he yearns to be. We all need our dreams. Lilies are meant to be beautiful. I look all right from the top bit up, thanks to my naturally blonde hair and what my now deceased grandmother used to kindly call elegant swan neck. But look below, and you'll find leftover puppy fat instead of a slender stem. No matter what I do, I'm stuck on the size 14 rail, and that's if I'm lucky. I know I shouldn't care, and Ed always says he doesn't, but I just do. On the way out, my eye falls on the stack of wedding cards propped up against Ed's records. Mr. and Mrs. E. MacDonald. The name seems so unfamiliar. Mrs. Ed MacDonald. Lily MacDonald. I've spent ages trying to perfect my signature, looping the Y through the M, but somehow it still doesn't seem quite right. The names don't go together that well. I hope it's not a bad sign. Meanwhile, each card requires a thank you letter to be sent by the end of the week. If my mother has taught me anything, it is to be polite. One of the cards has a particularly flamboyant "Look at me" scrawl in turquoise ink.
Davina was a girlfriend once,
Ed explained, before she turned up at our engagement party.
But now we're just friends.
I think of Davina, with her horsey laugh and artfully styled auburn hair that makes her look like a pre-Raphaelite model. Davina, who works in events, organising parties to which all the nice girls go. Davina, who narrowed her violet eyes when we were introduced, as if wondering why Ed would bother with a too-tall, too-plump woman like me. Can a man ever be just friends with a woman when the relationship is over? I decide to leave my predecessor's letter until last. Ed married me, not her, I remind myself. My new husband's warm hand now squeezes mine.
It will be all right, you know.
For a minute, I wonder if he is referring to our marriage. Then I remember. My first criminal client, Joe Thomas. Thanks. It's comforting that Ed wasn't taken in by my earlier bravado. And worrying, too. Together, we shut the front door, checking it twice because it's all so new to us, and walk briskly down the ground floor corridor leading out of our block of flats. As we do so, another door opens, and a little girl with long, dark, glossy, curly hair, looking as though it's trying to escape from that ponytail, comes out with her mother. I've seen them before, but when I said hello, they didn't reply. Both have beautiful olive skin and walk with a grace that makes them appear to be floating. We hit the sharp autumn air together.
The four of us are heading in the same direction, but mother and daughter are now slightly ahead, because Ed is scribbling something in his sketchbook as we walk. The pair, I notice, seem like carbon copies of each other, except that the woman is wearing a too short black...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.